do that over. That was not
That was kind of good. Especially with, look at how many people are with us this morning. Praise God. Good morning, everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen? Amen. It is good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Let us worship together as we have kids up here. Hey, this is actually a good segue. I don't think this is the first.
Right? It's almost like we planned it.
It's not the first announcement, but it's one of them.
Slide?
Let's go to this one. Not that. Nope. Keep going. Yep. Nope. Oh, it's not there. I didn't put it. It's in the other one. It's in the rolling announcements.
What are these, Pastor Matt?
Those are tickets, I think.
Tickets to what?
Those are tickets to a puppet show. I think it's Bob and Pink are making an appearance again.
So, Bob and Pink ride again? I got to pause and say, Charlie, I love your mask. I just got to tell you, brother, it's beautiful.
It is.
Bob and Pink are going on the road again. We are going to have another puppet show going around. We are going to be in Salem, in Pennsville, and in Carney's Point. All three addresses are on these tickets. If you are able to go yourself, or if you know of a child who you'd like to invite, there are stacks of these tickets on the table with our kids' packets. The
yellow one.
This one is for Carney's Point. The blue is for Salem. And the red is for Pennsville.
Mm-hmm.
So the Pennsville meeting is going to be here, kind of in the church side yard / Pastor Matt's backyard over by the playground equipment. So if you're not sure which one to give, that can be a good one here at the church. We are very excited. Last month, it was awesome. We had over 30 kids that got to hear the message of the gospel, and we got to celebrate together and praise Jesus, and we're doing it again. Special thanks to Daryl and Charlene for putting this together. Sorry for embarrassing you, but we love you and we're proud of you. And we really want to invite everybody to come out to this. If you got a chance to go last month, it is going to be a different play. So if you were there last time, you should come again. If you did not come last time, you should come this time.
You should definitely come this time. It was a lot of fun. And the best part about it was not only were 30 kids ministered to, but it was a lot of adults came, and some adults that were not necessarily Christians or not necessarily those who follow Christ. And it was great to see some of the parents interact with the adults, the leaders, and sharing Jesus Christ. And it was fun to see Nigel too. That was also a
That's
plus.
Right. Nigel came. So I hope Nigel comes again.
I hope Nigel comes again as well. So let's just keep that ministry in prayer. And it is on November 28th. It is not this coming Saturday, but next Saturday, the Saturday after Thanksgiving.
All right.
Now we can do the announcements.
A few other announcements. I don't know. Did we miss any? We're going back. Okay.
Now we're going.
So back to Experiencing God. We are starting a new Sunday school series. We believe it's starting the Sunday after Thanksgiving. That's correct, right? I guess
Carol's not
okay,
here.
So we're starting the Sunday after Thanksgiving. It's called Experiencing God. If you have done this series before, you can bring your old workbook. If you have never done this before, we're going to have workbooks available for you starting next week, so you can grab one and be ready. If you have questions, you should see Miss Carol about it. But we have bookmarks available for you to take. So the front has the Experiencing God logo, and the back has a guide. It's the 7 realities of experiencing God. And there are some promises on there. The first one, which is, of course, going to be one of the first themes we explore, is that God is always at work around you. And that's kind of what we're celebrating today as we talk about missions. So if you are interested, whether you're able to join us for Sunday school or not, you're welcome to grab a bookmark. If you would like a workbook, let me know so we have a count for the order. We are doing Sunday school in person from 9:30 to 10:30, but it is also available on Zoom. So if you are not able to come here for that time, or if you're at home watching us on Facebook, just know that you can join in with this series with us, even if you're not able to be here in person. So if you have questions about that, you should see Carol. And we are very excited about this series.
Yes, we are.
All right, what's next?
Our Sunday night Bible study is going to be tonight at 6 p.m., and we are going to be online on Facebook Facebook Live, and it is we are still in the book of 1 Corinthians.
That is right.
Our youth group, we are meeting also tonight at 7 o'clock, and it's going to be on Google Meet, so you will get that linked again tonight, and we are still kind of wrapping up our a little tiny series that we have about how God is sending us out.
Amen. Special announcement.
Your turn.
I guess I can take this one. So, as some of you might know, Pastor Matt and Lindsay are going to be moving on to the next stage in their journey pretty soon. Not heaven, we mean another church. As a celebration, November 22nd is going to be their last Sunday worshiping with us. So that night, we want to have a special gathering to celebrate them. We know that we have some rules about indoor gatherings, so we're going to set up a campfire back here behind the parsonage, and we're going to invite everybody to come and say hi to Pastor Matt for their last evening. We're going to have some time to pray together and some time to hang out. We're inviting the adults to come and join us at 6, and then youth group that normally starts at 7. The youth are welcome to come at 7 and stay, or they can come at 7 and hang out with Pastor Matt. That way they have a little bit of a, you know, special time with them and Pastor Matt and Lindsay. So you don't have to bring anything. We are outside, so technically you don't have to wear a mask, but they will be available, and if you'd like to wear one, some of us will be wearing masks. So that's...
I'm not sure if we're doing bring your own marshmallows, but you might want to find a stick.
Yeah,
bring your own sticks.
We don't have that set yet, but we'll let you know next Sunday.
All right. That'll be fun.
So that's going to be here at the church. We will not be having our normal Bible study on the 22nd. So just so everybody knows, here, campfire, probably some tears, but also love.
Yeah. On Friday, this Friday, the 20th, we have our final, darn it, I forgot what the name of it was. The Freedom Friday, the quest to save Lilliput. This is our thing that we tried to start doing during quarantine, and we came up with an idea of doing a game and where we're telling a story together. And our final story day is the 20th, and we are in person. It is here in room 6. Just remember, please wear a mask, and it's from 6 to 8 p.m.
All right, men's group, tomorrow night at 7 p.m., we are meeting here for men's group. We are still going through the life of David. We've got some interesting things going on. Joab was a little upset because his brother was killed by Abner, and there's going to be some consequences because of all that nonsense. So if you want to join us tomorrow, we're going to see what happens.
Mm-hmm. Our Wednesday night prayer and Bible study is also now in person. Please just wear a mask as you come in. We've got our Bible study. We're still in the book of Acts, and things are getting heavy. We're in, I think, Acts 16.
I
mix up numbers too, but we are...
We just got back to Antioch.
Yes,
first missionary journey. Paul and Barnabas just got back to Antioch of Syria.
Yeah, so that is happening on Wednesday. Also, not this Wednesday, not this coming Wednesday, but next Wednesday. I really hope that's the next slide. Next slide, Monica. Yay, it is the next slide. On
it's a ticket.
It's a ticket, Cody. It goes over there, yeah. So on Thanksgiving Eve, we are not having a community Thanksgiving Eve service, but we're doing a service here together, which is on November 25th. It's going to be at the same time as our prayer and Bible study, and it's going to be right here. So please come on out and join us for some fellowship together as we celebrate in Thanksgiving.
And that will be on Facebook Live, so again, we want to invite...
It is exactly
a month before Christmas, which reminds me, thank you, Josiah. Just a heads up, we are going to be doing a group devotional book over Advent. We'll have details available in a week or two, and we'll have books available for you guys. But we are doing the Advent devotional published by the Foundry from our denomination. So if you'd like to join in with that, stay tuned for next week when we will have more.
If you've missed any of our previous services or Bible studies, you can join us on YouTube, and if you search Pennsville Nazarene on YouTube. Isn't it great to have kids in service and just experience them? And
Yep. I miss stealing people's kids and bringing them up front with me, so I'm enjoying this a lot.
And I think our final announcement is about our crisis care kits. And thank you to all who have shared and given the different pieces of crisis care kits, but we still need more, don't we, Carol? We still need more parts. If you haven't already, please go out to the foyer and get a little cube that says what you can buy for a crisis care kit. If you take that square, please get that specific thing. If you're not able to get it, please put that square back where you found it, because we have a specific amount for exactly for what we need. So please share with, so please, if you're able to, for our crisis care kits, we're almost ready to send them back to Fawn Grove, but we still need some more parts. If you have any questions about that, please see Carol.
Hello. Yep. Sorry, I muted myself. So now we are going to gather together to pray for our offering. If you have already done so, if you've already put your offering in the baskets in the back, thank you. If you're here with us today, you're welcome to put your offering in the basket in the back. If you are joining us online, you can go to our website and click on the donate button. That's a great way to help support the ministries of this church. All these things that we're doing, like puppet shows and crisis care kits and things, they are all in part supported by the donations you guys make. So thank you very much for your faithfulness, and we are very excited by this. We do want to let everybody know that as part of our Thanksgiving celebrations, we will be holding a special offering later in the month for the World Evangelism Fund. I think you're going to hear a little bit of that when Angel speaks about the World Evangelism Fund and missions in our denomination. But we want to give everybody a heads up for that so you can prepare. 100% of the offering for World Evangelism Fund goes to missions. So we just want to let you know that that's coming up and invite you to join us in our ministry trying to share the gospel around the world. So please join me in prayer for the offering. Father God, thank you for this chance to be together today. Thank you for this chance to worship, to fellowship, to listen, to learn, to grow, to be challenged. Father, we thank you for this chance to give back your tithe and our offering. Father, I pray that you would help each and every one of us to be good stewards of all the resources that you've given to us, our time, our talents, and our treasure. And Father, I ask that you would help us as a church to be good stewards of those resources. Thank you for blessing us and taking care of us. Thank you for the generous way you've blessed us so that we might give to help other people. Thank you for all that you've done for us, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, I'd like to invite the worship team up. We're going to be joining in worship today. I'm very excited about the songs that we're singing. We're going to be starting off with Glorious Day. I left the day off, so it's just glorious. But we're going to be starting with Glorious Day. Now, I'm going to invite you to stand if you'd like to clap. It's very much encouraged for this song. This is a song of celebration, that this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. So please, stand and join us as we rejoice in the Lord.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into into your glorious day. Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, Jesus, when I met you, you called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. Rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
And let's continue our singing with Good Good Father.
Stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Ooh, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. 'Cause you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. unspeakable eye. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love, you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are.
Seated for a moment. Matthew 28:18-20 says this. I'm going to read from the Message this time. Jesus, undeterred, went right ahead and gave his charge. God authorized and commanded me to commission you. Go out and train everyone you meet, far and near, in this way of life, marking them by baptism in threefold name, in the threefold name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Then instruct them in the practice of all I have commanded you. I will be with you as you do this, day after day after day, right up to the end of the age. The reading of the Word of God. As we continue in worship, we know that God has called us, each and every one of us, to an act of love and service. And I pray that as we continue to worship him and sing, Great Are You, Lord, the God who gives life and love, the light in the darkness, that today that we will recognize that. And we will ask that question, how can I be a light in the darkness in my world? Let's worship him today.
If you could stand again with us if you're able, we are going to sing our next song, Great Are You, Lord.
You give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, it's your breath. Our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
Great.
give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. We'll shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing.
We gather together to pray. I do want to share one new request that just came in. We had a request that came in over Facebook for a gentleman who is in surgery right now having a kidney transplant. So we want to lift that up to you along with all the other needs of the church. So please join me in prayer. Father God, thank you for this day. Thank you for this chance to worship you. And thank you for that song, Father. You are great and worthy of our praise. And Father, there is nothing else in this world that is worthy of our love or our praise or our worship. Father, please help us to never forget that. Please help us to give all, to give everything to you, to hold nothing back and to give nothing anywhere else. Father, we thank you for that scripture passage that Pastor Matt shared, the great commission that your son gave us. Father, please help us to keep that at the center of everything we do, whether it's a puppet show or food pantry next Saturday. Father, please help your mission to be at the heart of every word we speak, every action we carry out, everything our church does, everything we do personally. Father, help it all to serve that mission of sharing your word, of making disciples, Father. Father, I know that in times like what we're going through now with challenged elections and rising positive test results for a virus and even more protests. Father, we know that these can be unsettling times, but as we face them, as we read the news, help us to remember that lesson from Bible school last year, that it doesn't matter how big our problems are. What matters is how big our God is. Father, help us to remember that you are bigger than any problem that we face and that your love is greater than any trial we might endure. Father, help us to remember those words you gave the Apostle Paul in Romans 8, that there is nothing that can separate us from your love as revealed to us through your Son. Neither heights nor depths, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries for tomorrow. No power in heaven or hell or in all creation That about covers it, Father. Help us to rest in that truth that overwhelming victory is ours through your Son, that we are more than conquerors, and that no trial will ever separate us from your love. Father, help us to not just remember that in our own hearts, but help us to share that with everyone that we meet. Please be with us as we gather to hear a word of testimony from Angel. Father, thank you for the call that you have put on her life to go and share your word around the world. Father, we pray a special blessing on her, both on the seeds that she planted while she served in Cambodia and for the new places that you are calling her to. Father, thank you so much for missionaries. Thank you for people who you call and who say yes. Please help us to always remember them in our prayers. Help us to always support them. And Father, help us to always carry that same passion in our hearts. In Jesus' precious name, amen. All right, I'd like to invite Carol up front here for a second. As I kind of hinted, we have a special guest speaker with us today. And we would like to take a moment and introduce her. So as I mentioned, our speaker today is Angel Jones. She's a local from Maryland. Did I remember that right? All right, so not too far from here. And she has served in Cambodia and is working on the next place to go with all of the travel restrictions, right? All right. So, Carol, I know I kind of prayed for Angel a little bit, but before she comes up and before she speaks, Angel, would you mind coming up here so we could say a special prayer for you just before you begin? We are very excited to have you with us, but we know that all the things that you've done have been through the power of God's work in your life, and we want to celebrate that and pray for God's continuing presence and call in your spirit. Sure, sorry, we're...
We can both lay hands on
all right.
Yes, and we were blessed with having Angel here because COVID wouldn't let her back. So thank you for coming to our church. Thank you for coming to our church. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for Angel and her ministry, Father God. We thank you, Lord, for those lost that she is ministering to, Father God. And we just thank you, Lord, for the work that you do through her, the love that you pour out of her, Father God, to all of those who are in Asia, Cambodia, wherever she ministers, Father God. Thank you that she is your vessel, that you pour your love through her, Father God, out to those to whom she ministers, Father. Now, Lord, let her words come from your throne today, Father God, that we would hear and understand those people on the other side of the world whom we have not met yet,
Amen.
Father, that we, that are our brothers and sisters or will be. Come, our brothers and sisters, soon, in Jesus' name.
Amen. All right, thank you, Ms. Cow, if you could give her the mic. So, I'd like everybody to give me a good morning, Angel, nice and loud. 1, 2, 3. Good morning, Angel. All right, so you are, that is on. Let's see if we're clicky. Okay. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You guys really are like the friendliest church ever. Okay, so I have 3 bags here. And in each of these bags, I have something which is vital for life, very essential. At least they are for life in Cambodia. So in the first bag, there's something that it's very universal. Everyone has it. But it's starting to be seen as a little bit outdated, especially with like the younger crowd and the more urban crowd, but still everybody has it. The second bag is a bit more widely used. Everyone has this and many of them will carry it around with them in their purse or bag. They just bring it with them wherever they go. But the item in the third bag, this is the most important item of all. And without this, people could literally die. They wouldn't survive. It's that important. So you might be wondering what can be so small and yet so important for life. Well, I'm going to tell you, but first let me introduce myself a little more. So my name is Angelina, but most everybody calls me Angel for short. So in 2010, I went to South Korea, and I taught English there. So not with the church, but still overseas experience, I guess. So I was in South Korea for 8 years, and then in 2018, I left. And then in 2019, I started serving as a sponsored missionary with the Church of the Nazarene. And I was assigned to Phnom Penh, which is very hot and crowded, but it's the bustling capital city of Cambodia. So in case you don't know where Cambodia is, I have a map. So at the top, you can see that pink, giant pink country, that's China. And then down at the bottom, there's like a khaki-colored one, that's Australia. Pretty much everything in the middle there is Southeast Asia, but as far as the Church of the Nazarene is concerned, only 5 countries are Southeast Asia, and Cambodia is right in the middle of those 5 countries, right there. So things are changing a little bit for me, as they are for pretty much everybody these days. So I was invited to spend a semester studying, taking some missions classes at Asia Pacific Nazarene Theological Seminary, which is in Manila, Philippines. So I'm actually supposed to be there right now, but due to COVID and travel restrictions and very strong lockdowns in the Philippines, I was unable to go. However, I'm still studying. I'm just doing it online. So I have to get up at 3:45 tomorrow morning for class, so that's fun. But I think there's like 2 weeks left, so it's fine. So I'm still studying, and then I'm gonna go ahead and take a couple more classes next semester as well. In the meantime, I'm just waiting until travel opens up and I'm able to go somewhere again. Even just yesterday, I received an email that they don't know when it's gonna be, but we're hoping it won't take too long. Okay, so back to these bags. So the item in bag number one, here, let me show you. So this is called a krama. A krama is probably the most quintessential item in all of Cambodian or Khmer culture. It's a checker-patterned scarf, but it's a little bit different than what we might think of as a scarf. So here, we wear a scarf in the winter because we're cold, or sometimes women will wear it just as an accessory. But kramas are different. They are hand-woven on a loom. They can be made from cotton or silk, and they are utilitarian. So whatever, anything you could do with a piece of cloth, you can use a krama for that. So sometimes people will roll it up and use it as a pillow. Sometimes they will unroll it and use it as a blanket or some kind of covering. Most often I see it used as a sweat rag or a way to keep the sun off your head because it's very hot. So if you see that woman has it tied around her head, a lot of people will wear it like that. Another use for it is that in Cambodia, especially out in the countryside, a lot of people don't necessarily have a bathroom in their home. And so they'll have like an outhouse type thing, but that they still don't have a shower. So what they'll do is they'll take a bucket and they'll go out in their front yard or backyard or whatever, and they'll take a piece of cloth like this krama, either a krama or there's another kind of cloth, but they will wrap it around themselves and then they will take a bucket shower. So I've seen that happen lots of times. You can use it to carry things, or you can use it as a belt. You can use it as a table covering. Basically, whatever you can do with a piece of cloth, you do with a krama. You can even use it as a handkerchief. So kramas permeate into many aspects of Cambodia, the life in Cambodia. So I started thinking about what other items or details or just what else in their culture is also ingrained into their society. And I thought of two right away. The first one is the Cambodian War, which ended only 41 years ago. I don't really want to spend a lot of time on that topic. If you're wondering about it, there is a lot of information online, or you're welcome to ask me later. By the way, if you have any questions, keep them in your mind, because you can ask me at the end of this time. So you're welcome to talk to me about it later, but I don't really want to go into it right now, except just to say that that war has had a very deep and lasting impact on their society. It has literally shaped their society. I am 33 years old, and I'm actually older than about 70% of the population there, just because of that war. The people are still dealing with the mental and emotional repercussions, and there's even more tangible evidence. If you're interested, one of the things is there are still active landmines. I have a book that's really interesting in the back, if you're curious. They've trained rats to come in and find these landmines so they can be removed safely. So if you're curious about that, you can ask me as well. It just in a whole lot of ways, in what they do in their daily life, in even the makeup of their population, that war has had a very lasting impact and has weaved its way into society. And the second thing that I thought of was Buddhism. So around 95% of Cambodians are Buddhist, and they even say to be Khmer is to be Buddhist. So it's literally a part of their personal identity and their cultural identity, which can be difficult when introducing Christianity, because if they change, they're giving up their very identity, because their identity is Buddhism. Cambodia is home to the largest religious monument in the world, which is Angkor Wat Temple, which is actually a whole... Oh, that didn't work. It's actually a whole complex of temples. It'll take you days to see them all. But this one is like the most famous, and it's kind of the front of the whole complex. This one is actually called Angkor Wat Temple. Also, in each community or neighborhood, they have a pagoda. So it's basically like a little small temple where people can go and pray. But also, they just kind of gather there for community events. Or if they just want to go for a walk, they just go walk around the pagoda. It's just kind of a community gathering place, but also a place where they can pray and worship. You can also find something called a spirit house. These will be in every household, every business. You can see them absolutely everywhere. And every day, people will place offerings on this spirit house as a way to appease the spirits or ghosts, because they don't want them to bring harm to their families or hurt them in any way. Many times if someone gets seriously ill or injured, or even if they pass away, the Khmer people will believe that it's because the spirits were angry with them and are punishing them. So these spirit houses are very important, and the giving of the offerings every day are very important. So that brings me to bag number two. Have any of you ever seen the movie My Big Fat Greek Wedding? Well, in that movie, the father of the family, his name is Gus, he believes that the remedy for any cut or injury or ailment, or even if you have a pimple, no matter what's wrong with you, the best thing to do is to spray Windex on it. It's like the magical medical cure-all. Well, in this bag, I have something called Tiger Balm. Oh, some people know what it is. Tiger Balm is like the Asian version of a medical cure-all. They'll tell you no matter what is wrong with you, you can use Tiger Balm. I actually got this here in Target, but over there, everybody has it, and they carry it around with them regularly. So, sometimes I would be studying, having a language lesson with my tutor, and if I had a headache, she would stop the lesson, and she would take out her Tiger Balm and rub it, like, on my head and neck and shoulders. When I had a bacterial infection, which is very easy to get there because the food is not always the cleanest, I was recommended to take this and rub it on my stomach, which does not work. When I've had a reaction to my food allergies, because I have strong food allergies, I've been told to use this, which also does not help at all. What does help, though, is when I had a stuffy nose and I couldn't breathe well, I was told to take just a little bit of this and rub it right on the rim of my nose. It works, but it burns like fire. It's so bad. If you're curious, you can smell this later. It's made of like menthol and kind of think like Vicks Vapor Rub, but has a bit of a different smell. This medical cure-all also comes in a self-sticking patch. Oh yeah, they use the red kind. I have the white kind. So you can take the Tiger Balm and place it right on the affected area and just stick it there, and it'll stay there for the whole day. So a lot of times you can see people walking around wearing a white patch on their forehead. It just means that they have a headache, so they're wearing Tiger Balm. But while Tiger Balm can relieve some physical symptoms, there are some things that Tiger Balm can't do. It can't fix the suffering that's brought on from the punishment of the ghosts or spirits. Or if someone gets dengue fever, which is a mosquito-borne illness, it can be quite dangerous and it's very common there. If someone gets dengue fever, Tiger Balm is not gonna fix it. So what do you do when your remedy for pain falls short? Well, the answer is in the third bag. So I told you that this bag is the most important of all. Do you have any guesses what it might be? Not a Bible, although that's the most common guess. No? It might be a little hard to see, but you can probably hear it if you can't see it. This is rice. Are you surprised that rice is the most important thing? Not too much? Okay, well, it may or may not be what you were expecting, but in Cambodia, rice is probably the single most important thing that exists. Rice is life itself. It's what sustains people. In many contexts, you can actually substitute the word rice and the word food. And then even when they greet each other, like we might say like, oh, hey, how are you? What they do is when they see each other, they say, nyam bai hai no, which means, have you eaten rice yet? It's such a common part of their everyday life that they even have multiple words for the rice, depending on what point it is in the process. So when it is still in the field, which that's what it looks like, it's called srai. And then once it's harvested, but it's not cooked yet, it's called onka. And then once it's actually cooked and ready to eat, it's called bai. Because they have to tell you exactly, you know, what they're talking about. When Khmer people eat together, they all sit around the table and each person has their own plate or bowl of rice. All the rest of the food will be put into the center of the table and they all will take it just bit by bit, really like a couple bites at a time because they wanna make sure that everyone has had a chance to get the food. But the rice is theirs. They have their own bowl of rice. That's what the main part of the meal is. So one day, I found this postcard. That's my tutor and her family, by the way, around the table. So one day I found this postcard that says that Jesus is the rice of life. I don't know how you feel about that, but when I saw it, I was a bit taken aback because it's such a well-known concept within our church culture that Jesus is the bread of life. And I think we all understand that it means that he can sustain us physically in the same way, he can sustain our souls in the same way that food keeps us going physically. But thinking about rice in the Cambodian context seems so much more powerful to me. Here in America, we eat bread a lot, but we aren't dependent on it. We have so many other options for food, and especially if you are like me and you are allergic to it, you definitely do not depend on it. But in Cambodia, rice is life itself. That's what you eat, that's what you live off of. So what happens when these people begin to discover that Jesus is the rice of life? Well, in those who have learned this, that Jesus can sustain us in the same way that rice nourishes their body, there's definitely a change and there is excitement. They are hungry for this life-saving rice and they want to share it with others around them as well. So at a meeting of the Cambodian district leadership last December, it's crazy that that's so long ago now, but at our that meeting, they were going around and sharing prayer requests with each other. And one of the specific prayer requests was that each of our Nazarene churches on the district there, which right now I think there are 62, I believe, official churches, and then some more that are not official yet. But their prayer request was that each of these churches would be able to receive 5 Bibles. That's not 5 Bibles like per household, like some of us probably have, but 5 Bibles for each church. One of the pastors, one of the leaders, he was able to get a hold of Bibles for around $5 each. However, a large percentage of the population lives off of only $1.20 per day. So $5 for a Bible can be really difficult. On top of this, many of our church people are actually farmers out in the countryside, so they really don't have a lot of extra money to be using. And not only that, but a lot of people are illiterate, which is also a product of the war that happened. So even if they had a Bible, it doesn't mean that they would actually be able to read it. But they wanted to know the Word of God. So that was their prayer, 5 Bibles for each church. Well, little did they know, but their prayers had already been answered before they had ever even asked it. There were already funds that were set aside and waiting for a need like this to arise. So this year in February at our district assembly, we were able to give each of the churches 5 regular Bibles, 2 hymnals, and then 1 Jesus storybook Bible for children, all in their language. And I have one of the children's Bibles in the back if you'd like to see it. We had so many stacks of books. We were trying to, you know, district assembly, everyone's talking and meeting about, who knows, finances or something. And we were in the back trying to set up these Bibles so we could gift it to these churches. And the table that we were using to arrange them on ended up buckling underneath the weight of all the Bibles, and the legs collapsed, and all the Bibles went sliding down to the floor in an avalanche, which I thought was pretty awesome, but it was a bit disruptive to the meeting. So you can see there, we were able to give a lot of Bibles. And since that time, I don't know the exact number, but I know they're still continuing to raise money for these Bibles, and so they just had a big thing where a lot of people were baptized, and they gave each of the new believers a Bible after they were baptized. And that's through the World Evangelism Fund that money comes from. But as great as it was for these churches to receive these new Bibles, they know that Jesus is not only the rights of life for themselves, but also for others as well. So that weekend, we were meeting in a hotel, and before we left, one of the churches had gifted one of their new Bibles to the security guard who works there. At other times, I've ridden in a van, and the pastor always sits up front in the passenger seat and spends the entire time, which is most likely hours, will spend the entire time telling the van driver that we hired to tell him about God and preach at him. They are also expert church planters. A lot of times I hear stories about how many churches do we have? Well, we're not sure, because last time we had a meeting, they said that there's now a new church here, and then they just went over to this village, and now there's a church here. They just, like, go to their neighboring villages and start churches. So right now, we don't actually have any ordained Nazarene ministers in Cambodia, locally. That will hopefully be changing this upcoming year. I think we have 6 who are ready for ordination. But if you don't know what that is, when you're becoming a pastor, you go through a course of study, you do some interviews, and things like that, and then you're recognized as an elder in the Church of the Nazarene. So right now we don't have any, but that doesn't stop them. They just keep going and preaching and telling everyone about God. And God is really on the move in Cambodia. So I started thinking about what the equivalent of rice would be for us in our culture. What is the most important thing that we can't live without? And the idea that I came up with was our phones. So I started thinking, what if the Bible said that Jesus is the iPhone of life, or Jesus is the Samsung Galaxy of life, or whatever kind of phone you have? So for many people, the first thing they do in the morning when they wake up is they check their phone. Maybe look at emails or Facebook or Instagram or whatever it is that you're interested in. What? Burger? Like a hamburger?
Yes.
Okay. So instead of bread, Jesus is the hamburger of life. Sounds good to me. So a lot of people check their phone first thing in the morning. But what if the first thing we did in the morning was to check in with Jesus? Before we leave for work or school, we always make sure we grab our phones and stick it in our pocket or put it in our purse. But what if it was Jesus we were making sure to bring with us? When we eat, a lot of times, people will take their phone and set it right on there on the table. That way we can just see if there's some important text message or notification that pops up. But what if it was Jesus that we were constantly communicating with? Instead of binge watching YouTube or Netflix, what if we spent time with Jesus? And I'm not saying that any of these things are necessarily bad or wrong. I do them too, especially in the morning, and I don't want to wake up. I just scroll through my phone. But my point is just that what if we acknowledge that Jesus was the very source of our lives in the same way that we feel we can't live without our phones? When I first felt God's calling on my life, it was specifically related to ministering to street children. And that's still the case, but while I was in Cambodia, that calling broadened up a bit to include others who have been forgotten about in society or looked down upon, those who believe that they have no value or whom others cast aside. Especially in a place like that where they don't make a lot of money, it's very easy for people to come in and just take advantage of them. And so I want to go to people like that and to love them and care for them, but then also, of course, to let them know that Jesus loves them and cares for them and that he is the source of their life. But do you know what? That is what God has asked of you as well. We are co-workers in this, and we are partners. I don't know if you know what the mission of the Global Nazarene Church is, although you read it a little bit ago, earlier in the service, but it's Matthew 28:19, which says, "Go and make disciples of all nations." So whether you go across the world like me, or just across the street to your neighbor, we are all called to go, to reach out. That may mean actually talking to someone and telling them about Jesus, or it may mean just showing them kindness and, you know, being a sympathetic shoulder and being an example for them. There's a lot of ways you can be Jesus to somebody. So I don't know if you can read that. I found this quote online, but it says, "Don't wonder whether you have a call to go. Have you ever had a distinct call from Christ to stay at home?" So we're all called to go. In addition to going, there are a couple other ways that you can be involved in God's mission. The first is to pray. So I would ask that you please pray for me as I follow God's calling on my life, for the people who I will meet, and for our brothers and sisters, our Nazarene brothers and sisters in Cambodia who are actively reaching out to their neighbors. And the next way is give, of course. Every year, churches around the world participate in the World Evangelism Fund. Gifts and donations that are made to this fund, without those gifts, like Nazarene missions couldn't function, because those donations go for providing the resources and support that we need in order to maintain our ministries. And in Cambodia specifically, as I talked about the Bibles, a lot of that funding has come through the World Evangelism Fund. But even Alabaster, if you know what Alabaster is, right now, okay, so Cambodia is not that big, but it's one of those countries where it'll take you a really long time to drive wherever you're going. And so right now we have our main ministry center in the capital city, but most of what we do, it takes place in the countryside, and there's a city that's closer. And so we're looking to build a ministry center up in that other city, which has not even started yet. I think they're looking for land right now, but that is coming through Alabaster. So any gifts to the World Evangelism Fund and Alabaster are helping us to build our district ministry center there. And your church is a part of this as well. So it's not just your church or your district or even the U.S. It's worldwide. Churches around the world are giving to this World Evangelism Fund. So, and I know this is something that your church is a part of as well. So I want to thank you for how you are already involved in missions through that. And then I've heard about, you know, how you've invited other missionaries to come here. And so I really want to thank you for how you are supporting missions here. There's one more. The last way you can be involved is to follow. So I'm pretty sure you can't read that, but I have some prayer cards in the back, and you are welcome to have one. This is how you can keep in touch with me. So it has my email. I have a Facebook group if you would like to see updates and pictures and things like that. I don't have a lot of pictures on here, but if you go online, there's a lot more pictures. I have Instagram, and then also my giving link, the donation is there. I will have that in the back. And if you have any other questions, you're welcome to ask me that too. So before I finish, I have one more short story for you. So every morning in the streets of Phnom Penh, and actually all over the country, but I lived in Phnom Penh, so that's what I saw. But every morning you can see monks walking around dressed in bright orange robes, and they carry a metal pail on a strap. They walk down the street going from house to house or business to business, and they stay outside while the people who are inside that home or business come out to the entryway. They will give the monks an offering, and then in exchange, the monks will give them a spiritual blessing. Many people will also actually go see the senior monk. I don't know if you can see it there, but if you go see the senior monk, he will give you a thin red bracelet that's made of string. So you can see he's tying it on the girl there. This bracelet, the monk is believed to grant divine power into this bracelet. And so this bracelet is able to protect the wearer from harm or from any misfortune that the spirits bring. But this protection is only temporary. It wears off after a while, and then after that, a new one is needed. It's insufficient. It doesn't last, and it doesn't work. So I would ask that you please pray with me that those who put their faith and trust into simple string and those who go to the monks for their protection from harm, that you would pray with me that they come to know that the monks don't have the answer and that Tiger Balm can't heal their wounded souls, but that Jesus is the true lasting source of protection and that he is our sustenance and that Jesus is the rice of life. Thank you very much. And if you have questions, you're welcome to ask me.
We have a few minutes right now, so if anybody would have a question, you can raise your hand and we can ask them.
I have a question, Angel. You mentioned those, and I forgot what you called them, that are everywhere, where they give offerings.
The spirit houses?
Spirit houses.
Yeah. So usually, I don't really know how they choose it, but let me go back and show you. Oh, too far. Yeah, so I don't know how well you can see it. In the middle there, there's like a pink thing, and there's some kind of sticks sticking out of it. That's incense. So they'll burn incense. And then you can also see some things scattered around kind of on the top of that. Those are pieces of candy. They have different things. So they might put out food, or I think they also might put out drinks. I'm not totally sure. But you see candy a lot, and definitely incense. Most of the time, they look like the one on the right. So it's kind of like a really ornate birdhouse, almost, sitting on top of a pedestal. But there are a couple different kinds. There are ones that are wooden, so they're cheaper. And then there's also ones that are made specifically for the child ghosts. And so what they give as an offering kind of depends on who they're offering it to. So if they have one of these child spirit houses, they're going to put, I don't know, maybe more candy and toys and things like that. And if they have, you know, one of the normal ones, not that the other ones aren't normal, but one of these kind, then Yeah, you'll see like food and snacks and things like that a lot, but definitely incense. Okay, so Cambodia is, so officially it's not a closed country. The government doesn't prevent that from happening. But because they are so strongly Buddhist, a lot of times the families will kind of prevent that from happening. So like, it's really hard for someone to decide to become Christian because they have to give up Buddhism. And then also if they become Christian, their family may be very angry, they may not speak to them anymore, they may say terrible things to them, just because it's like they're disowning them. I asked my tutor, actually, about what do Cambodian people think of Christians, and she said there's two main thoughts, and one of them is that Christians are good, and they help a lot, and they really care, because there's a lot of ministries and NGOs and things like that. But on the other hand, a very widely held belief is that Christians don't care about their family, which in that culture is horrible. And the reason they think that is because the verses that are like, you know, if someone wants to be Christ's disciple, he has to leave his father and mother, those kind of things. And so they see that, and in that culture, that's horrifying. And so that can be a big obstacle, is they don't want to be Christian because that means they don't care about their family, and that's what's most important. And so it's not really the government that causes problems, but within families, there can be some strong opposition.
So is there persecution to those who are teaching Christianity?
Mostly persecution comes from families. I have heard about a little bit otherwise, but I don't know enough details, and it's probably not something I should share, but most of the time it comes from the families. So it just depends on the individual and their specific context.
So
I knew someone who was already there, so I had heard a lot of stories beforehand. So I don't know about surprising. There are definitely some funny things. This is not some deep thing, but just a cultural thing. They use MSG in everything when they cook, and they, like, you can buy it by the giant bagful. And they will tell you, like, if you don't put in MSG, it's not delicious. And so if you cook something without MSG and you give it to them and they eat it and they actually like it, they'll go on and on because they're so shocked that something could be cooked without MSG and it's delicious. Another thing is, like I said, I'm older than quite a large number of the population. And so women there tend to get married pretty young, in their 20s at least. Probably, if they're past mid-20s, they're definitely on the old side. And so I was talking to someone, and they're very, I don't know the word, I can't think of it right now. They'll just ask you anything personally in that culture, and it's not considered rude. So like, random people I met on the street that I've never even said hello to would just come up and say, how much do you weigh? Things like that. But I had this one woman, and she was talking to me, and she was like, well, do you want to get married? And I'm like, well, yeah, sure, you know, if I find someone to get married to. And then she was like, well, can I ask how old you are? So I told her, and immediately she changed, and she was like, oh, no, you're too old. Oh, I'm sorry. And she, like, was so embarrassed that she had asked me that, because I'm so old in that culture. So, yeah, there's just some funny things like that, but I don't know about anything that's super surprising, but just a lot of little cultural differences that are actually pretty major for Americans.
I have a question about the spirit houses. You know, you mentioned persecution from
So I don't know if my answer is exactly 100% accurate, because I've never really thought about it before. But from what I've seen, there hasn't been too much, like, opposition to that. So, like, I moved into an apartment, and the owner of that apartment had two spirit houses installed inside. And I was going to just, like, throw a sheet over it and pretend that it wasn't there, and then I was too creeped out, and I was like, no, I can't do it. So I asked her to remove it, and she was like, yeah, sure, and she took it out, and it was fine. If they take it out, I mean, I guess it would depend on who it was and what that business was. Maybe some of the employees might not like it, but, like, it's not everywhere, because a lot of, you know, the NGOs, they're not going to have that in there, or, like, the ministries are not going to have that. My language school, actually, I'm not sure if my language school had one or not. They might have. I think it's more a personal thing. So, like, if someone else doesn't have a spirit house, I don't think someone's going to go to them and be like, where's your spirit house? Yeah, so I haven't seen that being too much of an issue, but also they're everywhere, so most everywhere has one. So it might be that I just, you know, haven't experienced, like, haven't seen somewhere not have it, if that makes sense. There's a bank that has a really giant one. I've never stood next to it, but I think it's taller than I am, like, outside their door. It's humongous. But, yeah, they're everywhere. But I think it's more personal, your relationship with that. The other day I just learned that it's actually, the Khmer word for it is, like, angel tower. And so I was looking at the word, and I was like, what? It was, sorry, this is a random story. I have to read an article for one of my classes, and it has this written with English letters, but the English letters are very strange and not how I would write it. And so I was reading, and like, what is that? I don't know what that word is. And then it wasn't until I actually tried to say it out loud and heard the sound of it, I was like, oh my gosh, it's Deoda, which means angel, which is my name. So the whole time I was sitting there trying to understand it, and it was my name. But yeah, they're called like Angel Tower or something like that. Any other questions?
How did you end up in Cambodia? How was that the place
you ended up? Because, so I was living in South Korea, and I knew that I needed to go somewhere, and I had known that for a while. But I didn't really know what to do or how to go anywhere, and I really didn't know how the system works. So, like, now if I were to go searching, I could find something easily, but back then I just didn't know. And so anytime I tried to search, like, online or whatever, I just couldn't find anything. And then someone that I knew, a friend of mine back in Korea, she knew the people who were working in Cambodia. And so she said, like, why don't you contact them? And so I did. And then they put me in contact with someone else. And then she put me, kind of introduced me to an organization that does, like, anti-trafficking kind of thing. And so I was actually going to go with that organization. I had the date to arrive and everything. And then something happened that was kind of major, and I couldn't go. And I ended up back in the States for, like, 9 months. So I was in Virginia. And then during that time, I switched over to the Nazarenes and went that way. So right now, basically, I don't know what's going to happen. Those leaders who were there have left. They're now pastoring a church here in the States. And because of COVID and because of the leadership change, things have been reorganized. And so I'm hoping to go back to Cambodia, but I don't know for sure if that will happen. If it doesn't, I will probably be in one of the neighboring countries right around there. But yeah, basically a friend of a friend kind of thing. That's how I ended up there. So I was there for 8.5 months. So most of the time, so I was living and working in the district office. So like if they had something they wanted me to do, some paperwork or organizing some books, or one time I painted our church benches, like whatever random thing, they would just ask me to do it. And then I also went to intensive language school. So literally from day one, I arrived at like 11 p.m. on June 30th, and by I think it was 8 or 8:30 the next morning, I was in language school. So I studied quite intensively to learn language and culture and things like that. There is a team there. I mean, I went by myself, like on the plane and everything, but there is a team there. So right now we have our district superintendent and his wife, but they are actually, so they're new. When the others leaders left last year, they appointed these people as leaders in like February, I think, but because of COVID, they haven't been able to get in the country. So they're actually still in Thailand. But they're the district superintendent from afar. And then there's a single girl who's there working, and then there are two Korean families who are there, who are also part of the team. Do they like Americans? I mean, I think so. They've been perfectly, you know, friendly and everything. I haven't had any issues. So, yeah, I think they're, yeah. This thing? No. I mean, it's good to take with you if you go out into the countryside because it's a lot of, like, dirt roads. It's very hot all the time. The other day it got down to like 73 degrees and everyone was like going crazy, posting on Facebook how cold they were and they need sweaters. And like that, like 73 degrees, they have a word that means severe winter. And that's what that is for them. Because it's quite often like over 100. And so you don't have to wear these, but it's kind of a good idea to take them with you. You'll be dirty from the dust of the road. You'll be sweaty. It's just, you know, good to have, but you don't have to wear it. Kinda, yeah. The tiger bomb, I've seen there was one time we were in a van and I was all the way in the back and the guy all the way in the front took his out to rub it like here on his shoulders. I guess maybe his neck hurt or something. And it was just like overwhelming because it's a very powerful smell. But it's pretty good. It does help. As long as you use it for the right thing. Like, do they say anything about it, or do we say? They just think that they didn't do it right, or that they didn't give the right offerings, or whatever they did, it didn't appease the spirits. And so they actually, one of their biggest holidays, there's like two main holidays, and one of them, like the whole point of this holiday is you're supposed to go to seven different Buddhist temples and give your offerings to the spirits for the coming year. And you just do as much as you can. And if you don't do it, I mean, there's no like punishment, but you kind of take it on yourself as a risk, like I didn't do enough, they might, you know, cause me trouble during this year. So if something happens, it's not like, oh, it didn't work. They just think, oh, it's my fault, I didn't do enough, I should have done more, I should have offered something different, things like that.
Well, thank you so much, Angel. I'm gonna give you a break for a second and let you catch your breath. Angel does have a table set up out in the foyer, so when we're all finished today, she's going to be out there for a little bit. You're good. So if you want to stop out and see, she has the children's Bible that she mentioned, lots of postcards, all that. But before you go, I just want to let everybody know, we are going to be taking a love offering to help support Angel in her ministry. So if you'd like to support that offering, we have the offering baskets at the back of the church, right by the door. So if you're going to go see her table, they're right on the way. If you'd like to write a check for that offering, you can write it out to our church, and we'll get it all together and then give her one payment. If you're giving online, you can make a note that it's for Angel Jones, and we'll make sure that that gets to her. Just thank you so much for your graciousness, for your time. I know there's a lot of questions here. Thank you for following Jesus.
Thanks for asking questions. I appreciate that, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, well, we're very excited to have you. So since we took lots of extra time for questions, we're going to go ahead and close the service in a quick prayer. So I'll give Angel a second to get to her table. But we are going to say another quick prayer here before we finish up. I hope you hear what she said, that there are lots of different ways we can serve, whether it's called to go speak to your neighbor who's next door. You know, I think we have a great neighborhood missionary in Eric. He knows every neighbor of his that's in the hospital or needs help. we have people here like Charlie who've been to other countries several times on short-term trips. There are lots of different ways to go serve. We have the laymen at the mission, right? It's right there in the name. Our mission is to share Jesus with everybody we meet, whether that's the house next door to us, the coworker that we see every day, people in another country. So I'd like you to take a moment as we pray and think about how God is calling you to follow. Where is God sending you? Like that quote Angel shared, unless God called you to stay at home, you've got to get out. You've got to go. So let's take a moment and pray for God's wisdom in our lives. Please join me. Father God, thank you for Angel's testimony. Thank you for the work that you're doing in Cambodia. Thank you for churches that are getting planted so fast they can't be counted. Thank you for loving friends who welcome new people in the name of Christ. Father, we lift up Angel to you specifically. We pray for her safety and provision as she's preparing new travels. Father, we pray that you would open the correct doors to get her back into Southeast Asia, whether that is for her to go back to Cambodia or to go to another country. Father, we pray that you would make those steps happen in the right order and in a clear way so that Angel would know and see, and so that the next time we see her, she would have a testimony for how you took care of her. Father, I also lift up each and every one of us here in this room and listening online. Father, I pray that you would speak to our hearts. I pray that your Spirit would give us that nudge or that push. Father, help us to know how you would have us serve, where you would have us go. Father, if there is a specific person you'd have one of us share with, put it on our hearts today, Father. If there is a specific place that you would have us go where you'd like us to minister, maybe it's a prayer group at lunchtime. Maybe it's the corner store. I don't know, Father. But please, whatever it is, speak to our hearts. And as you speak, help us to listen. Help us to hear that. Father, I pray for that scripture that we shared to be lived out, to go and make disciples. Father, it is such a blessing to have been given your grace and your love and your forgiveness. And Father, please help us not to keep it to ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you for joining us here today. I ask that you go in God's grace. Know that God loves you and that you are being sent out into the world. If you'd like to speak with Angel, she's out in the foyer. If you would like a children's packet or tickets to the puppet show, those are on the table right over here by the door. Thank you so much. Go in God's name and be blessed. Oh, candles are out. I guess we're done.